Good morning. And if you would recall, last time we started our discussion about the entry modes into international business, out of which our focus was on foreign direct investment. And we saw that one of the prominent forms of foreign direct investment is joint ventures. And we discovered many facts about joint ventures. And we also discussed as to how we can ensure that there is synergy in terms of strategic fit of the business logic and business ambitions of the joint venture partners. But then there is another very important form of foreign direct investment, which we call as mergers and acquisition. And in today's class, our focus will be on understanding mergers and acquisition, particularly the cross-border mergers and acquisition. So as is the usual practice, we'll define the terms mergers and acquisition. What is merger? Merger is a combination of two or more companies into a single company. And this combination can happen either through the process of absorption or consolidation. And then the next question is, how do they differ? So when you talk about merger through absorption, this is a combination of two or more companies into an existing company. So here in this instance, all companies will lose their identity except for one. For example, there is a case of Komatsu Limited, which is a Japanese company. They had another company called Komatsu Diesel. And in this instant case, the survival of Komatsu Limited continued, but Komatsu Diesel merged its entity into Komatsu Limited. And in the process, Komatsu Diesel transferred all its assets, liabilities and shares to Komatsu Limited. Very recently, we have a new case of Larsen & Toubro's Electric and Automation Division being sold to Schneider Electric's India operation. And this incidentally is the case of acquisition of the Larsen & Toubro's Electric and Automation Division. The deal was for rupees 14,000 crore. And now Schneider India would like to use this particular project to use India as an export destination for some of its product. And this acquisition concluded in the month of August. And now it is working on a 100-day plan to merge the company. So how does this process of 100-day plan of merger or acquisition work? This we will see later in our presentation. And you can see over here that this is a news item in Mint. And the link is here. And you can see the information about this particular case. And the information is all available over here. And this is the case of divestment. When a business is not in the core area of operation, the company decides to sell off that business. And this process is also known as divestment. And as you can read over here, the group chairman of Larsen & Toubro, Mr. A.M. Naik, believed that Schneider Electric was the right partner to grow the business that L&T had nurtured over a period of time. And this will be a win-win situation for the employees, business partners and shareholder. And this deal happened through cash transaction. So this is all cash deal. And this will allow L&T to focus on the key business. So this is a complex transaction, and there is a direct share purchase transfer of the share. Okay, so this is how it happens. So as part of this, the 5,000 employees of the L&T business will become part of Schneider now. So this is how the entity has been merged. Okay, so I hope this is going to give you some clarity about the process of merger and acquisition. Now let's define what is merger through consolidation. Here what happens is that two or more companies, they merge together to create an altogether new entity or a new company. So we say that consolidation is a contractual and statutory process by which two or more corporations jointly become a completely new corporation, and this corporation is what we call as the successor corporation. The original companies will no longer exist and do business, and the new company will acquire all the assets and liabilities of the earlier companies. Now again, there is a recent example of a merger between Dow Chemicals and DuPont. Both of them are in the similar area of operations and business, and this merger was actually announced in 2015, but it took 2 years to complete the process, and finally the deal was clinched in the year 2017. We'll see in future slides about the due diligence process and how the process of mergers, acquisition is not a one-shot game, and it continues for a long time till both the companies actually are able to synchronize their strategic objectives. So both Dow Chemicals and DuPont are examples of the mergers aimed at creating a focused business, and their focus is in the area of material science, agriculture and specialty products. And this company is known as Dow DuPont, and it is listed on the New York Stock Exchange. And how the shareholders benefited? For the Dow Chemical shareholders, each one of them received one share of Dow DuPont for each Dow Chemical share that they had with them before the merger was conceived. And on the other side, if you look at the DuPont shareholders, they received 1.282 shares for each DuPont market share that they held before this particular merger. But then there is another classification of merger. And as per this classification, we say that there are three types of mergers. One, horizontal merger, then vertical merger, and the third one is known as the conglomerate merger. How do we define horizontal merger? It is the combination of two or more businesses in the same area of business. So we have this example, which we just now saw, of DuPont and Dow's Chemical, where they were working in the related area. There could be another combination of two luggage manufacturing companies or maybe two book publishing companies. So this is the instance of what you call as the horizontal merger. Now, what is the vertical merger? This is more interesting. It is actually a combination of two or more firms, and these firms are involved in different stages of production or distribution of the same product. Recall the value chain analysis, where we identified the distinct links in the value chain, starting from inbound logistics, operations, outbound logistics, marketing and after sales services, along with the other support activities such as procurement and R&D and human resource management. Sorry. So to give you another example of vertical merger, suppose there is an assembly line of TV manufacturing. Okay, we are now at the stage of the final company which is selling the product under its brand name. After assembling different components, they manufacture TV and sell it in different markets. So, you know, if this particular company also gets one of the company which produces the display into it, then that is a case of vertical merger. And since we are, you know, actually moving towards the supplier, it is called backward merger. But suppose there was a distribution company and that company is merged with this particular company, then since we are moving much closer towards the customer in terms of our engagement, then we call this as the forward merger. And then we have another distinct one, the conglomerate merger, which is a combination of the firm in unrelated lines of business activity. So suppose a manufacturing company producing steel merges with a cement company, or a fertilizer company merges with an electronic product company. So these are different cases of what you call as the conglomerate merger. We have seen L&T, how it is into different areas, but most of them are related to engineering and projects and consultancy. And Voltas India is a Tata Group company, but they are into refrigeration and air conditioning and all such businesses. So these are not related businesses. So such a merger will classify as a conglomerate merger. Now we move to the sphere of acquisitions and takeover. An acquisition is defined as an act of acquiring effective control by one company over assets or management of another company without any combination of the companies, whether it is consolidation, whether it was the case of absorption. The basic tenet in the merger definition was combination of companies. Here, it is not about combination. So in an acquisition, two or more companies may remain independent, separate legal entity, but there may be a change in the control of the companies. Now we have another recent example, not so recent obviously, because the world is moving too fast. The technology landscape is undergoing metamorphosis every year. So in 2005, Google acquired Android for an estimated $50 million. And you know, when this deal was stuck, Android was unknown mobile startup company. And because of this particular deal, Google was able to have a good presence in the market, which was earlier, you know, dominated by Microsoft with Windows Mobile and Apple with iPhone. And this deal is a successful acquisition example. And currently, if you look at the US market, 54.5% of, not currently, in 2018, the data for which is available on Statista, 54.5% of US smartphone subscribers were using the Google Android device. Then we have another example of acquisition, where Facebook bought WhatsApp for $19 billion in 2014. And prior to that, they had also bought Instagram in 2014. And that deal was for $1 billion. So mergers, acquisition is now part of the dominant business activity. Incidentally, for those of you who are watching the recent activities on Instagram, you will notice that Facebook obviously is the biggest social network worldwide, and it has 2.7 billion monthly active users as per the information for the second quarter of this year. And as per this very report in Statista, the same report says that Facebook will reach 442.2 million active users in India by 2023, which is about 44.4 crore active users. And this is a reflection of the growth and popularity of Facebook, and I mean both worldwide and India also. And the recent activity which you might have noticed is that Facebook has decided to merge Messenger chats with Instagram direct messages, and I'm sure many of you would have seen the message to that effect. So, talking about acquisition and takeover, let us also make a distinction between the term acquisition and takeover. So, when an acquisition is forced, the other party is unwilling, we call this as a takeover. And in an unwilling acquisition, the management of the target company would oppose the move of being taken over. But in the opposite situation, when the managements of the two companies, the acquiring company and the target company, mutually and willingly agree for this particular combination, it is called acquisition or friendly takeover. Okay, but remember, acquisition or takeover does not necessarily entail full legal control. And if you look at the Indian stock market, you will find that the share pattern is such that most entities have very limited percentage of the stock of a given company, and therefore at times even 10% becomes good enough for effective control of an organization. Now, what are the reasons for the dominance of mergers and acquisition as a part of global business? So there are distinct reasons. Number one, through this process, the company's growth is accelerated. Many instances, you will find that the company is not able to have the requisite resources for entering a new business, creating a new product line, or spending into evolving area of technology, or sometimes it is not able to develop the kind of special skills which are required, or having access to the distribution channel depth. And in such instances, if the company acquires an existing companies or companies, then it can grow quickly and fulfill its objective. So that is the primary objective for merger and acquisition. In addition to that, it helps in enhancing profitability. With size, you will also get the profit. So when two or more companies are combined, there is an increase in average profitability because of the cost reduction and efficient utilization of the resources. We'll talk about synergy also in later part of our discussion. So we all have used this term very often, economies of scale of production, which arises when we increase the volume of production, which leads to reduction in the cost of production per unit. Remember, the fixed costs are absorbed at a particular volume, and after that it is only the variable cost that goes into equation, and therefore the cost of production will go down as we increase the volume of production. So economies of scale may arise from other factors such as the production facilities. You may, as part of the acquisition or merger, get access to a better, more efficient production facility with state-of-the-art processes such as Six Sigma, Lean, and total quality management, and there would be a better management and system of resource pooling and the overall management structure. So this is one advantage. The other is the factor of operating economies. When two or more companies combine together, you may decide to do away with some of the duplicating activities. So reduction in overlapping function is an advantage, and this helps in consolidation of functions such as manufacturing, marketing, R&D, and therefore operating costs are also minimized. So here there is an example of combination of firm eliminating the duplicate channel of distribution, or they can create an integrated planning and control system so the inventory management becomes more effective. So there are profitability associated with economies of scale of production and the operating economies. Then the other factor is it helps to diversify the risk of the particular company. When the company acquires those business whose streams are not correlated, and there is what you call as diversification, which is growth through combination of firms in unrelated businesses, and this will result in reduction of total risk because the cyclicity of the operations can be taken care of. We discussed earlier as to how the unforeseen economic factors which could otherwise endanger the survival of the individual companies related to a particular market can be offset by the growth or profitability arising in the other part of the world through the operation in other part of the world who are witnessing different aspects of the economic cycle. Then there is improved market reach and the industry visibilities. Companies more often buy companies to reach new markets and revenue and earning. And you know, when two companies marketing and distribution when two companies actually merge, there is an expansion of the marketing and distribution function, and therefore they can now tap new sales opportunities. And in the investment community, a bigger firm is always having a better reputation as compared to the smaller ones. Bigger firms often have an easier time raising capital as compared to the smaller ones. And other than that, the severity of the competition can also be limited by increasing the company's market power. So Schneider India will now have more power to deal with other competitor in the business that it is dealing with. So when we talk about mergers and acquisition and the reason and the motivation for cross-border mergers and acquisition, we often discuss about synergy. What is synergy? Synergy implies a situation where the combined firm's worth is more valuable than the sum of the individual companies which are getting combined. So it is about benefits other than those related to economies of scale. We discussed about operating economies, and this is a form of synergy benefit, where apart from operating economy, synergy also arises from enhanced managerial capabilities, creativity, innovativeness, R&D, market coverage, capacity due to the complementarity of resources and skill and a widened horizon of opportunities. And if you want to explain it symbolically, we say that if a company A merges with company B, the value of the merged entity, which we call as AB, is expected to be greater than the sum of the independent value of company A and B, as you can see over here. So economies of scale happens because there is a reduction of the staff. Merger tends to mean job losses, and this money that is saved through the retrenchment of the staff members used for other purposes, for the consolidation of the company, and then obviously you acquire new technologies to stay competitive. And many times you buy the smaller company with unique technology, and we saw the case of the Google's acquisition of Android, and which has given a competitive edge to Google. And in addition to that, if you look at the financial synergy, as you have more scale of business in terms of your capital, so the debt capacity also is higher, because the merger of two companies brings stability of cash flows, which in turn reduces the risk of insolvency and enhances the capacity of the new entity to service a larger amount of debt. And this factor is known or noticed by the investment community. And because there is a financial stability, The merged firm is able to borrow at a lower rate of interest vis-a-vis the other players in the market. Now, before we actually go further, I think we need to understand that, you know, what is the economic valuation of this particular exercise that we are taking up. So, as you can see over here, we are actually looking at the financial result arising out of this particular venture, but in particular, we need to focus on the financial evaluation of the deal, which is about the earning and the cash flow, making an estimation about the areas of risk and how it is going to make an impact on the deal, what could be the maximum price that can be paid to the target company, what is the best way to finance the merger. And we normally say that the current market value is the correct and fair value of the share of the target firm. The target firm will not accept any offer below the current market value of its share, and the target firm may in fact expect the offer price to be more than the current market value of the share, because it may expect that merger benefits will accrue to the acquiring firm and all the future cash flows of this company will now get transferred to the acquiring firm. So let us understand how companies actually make valuation of the potential buyer. Okay, so economic valuation is necessary for a potential buyer to decide at what price it is willing to conclude the deal. Okay, or in the case of a merger, the relative proportion of shares to be exchanged. And there are three main methods which will help you to understand why, you know, current market value is a good indicator of the value of the firm. So these three methods you may write down. There are three methods used for economic valuation. Number one, asset-based valuation. Number two, market-based valuation. Number three, cash flow-based valuation. Now let us take up each one of them. So when it is about asset-based valuation, this method determines the actual value of the assets minus the liabilities using a replacement price for physical assets and adjusting for the inventories or debtors' book value. And intangible assets and goodwill are estimated using the comparable value for similar businesses using formulas such as rupee per customer or dollar per customer. This method is useful when the assets are predominantly physical. So for a typical manufacturing entity, this approach may give a fair estimation of the value, but if the company's profitability relies on intangible resources, for example, the patent or the R&D or employees' commitment, then this method will fail to give a good economic price. Therefore, we move to the next one, which is the market-based valuation. This approach relies on direct market valuation. If the company is listed on the stock exchange, so if the stock exchange market value is taken, the transaction will require that the bidder will put a premium on the deal. And why a premium? Premium are based on an anticipation of the value added from the merger, either short term or long term, through the process of synergy, which we just now saw. And in research, it has been found that 30 to 100% premium over the market value are found to be traded in cross-border acquisition. Now, you may ask why such higher premium is paid, because many times, as we saw the case of L&T, the business is based on solid foundation. It has a good base of the customers. However, it now wants to focus on the core areas, and therefore it wants to divest its share in this particular case through Schneider India. Okay, but Schneider India will continue to get all the money flow, cash flow, which will accrue in future. So you make an estimation of that cash flow, and that is the point of reference for premium, and therefore it may go even as high as 100% of the market value. When the target company is not listed on the stock market, one can use market equivalent measures such as the P ratio, which is calculated from some similar deals of comparable companies. And then we have the third option, that is the cash flow based valuation. We saw that cash flow estimation is important even when you are going for market based valuation. So economic theory says that apart from actual market price put on the stock market, this method is equally attractive. So within this method, the value of the firm's equity is equal to the net present value of the future cash flow discounted with the weighted average cost of capital minus the debt. Okay, so when you typically do the calculation for the future future cash flows, how does it move? You have revenues, and then from revenue you deduct the cash cost, then you deduct the increase in the working capital which will be required for future processes, then you deduct the future investment which the acquiring company will be required to make, the taxes that have to be paid on account of this particular deal. So this actually will give you the estimate of the future cash flow. And there are two major kind of future cash flows which need to be valued in mergers and acquisition. The first is the future cash flow of the merging or the acquired company, calculated if the company, if you assume that the company continued its activity without this particular merger. So if that was the case, how much was the value added? Similarly, the future value of the added value brought in short term and long term by the merger of the two companies, and this is what you call as the synergies value. So both of these are actually part of the valuation. So I thought that when we are talking about financial evaluation, when we are talking about synergy, financial synergy in particular, let us understand as to how do we come up with the valuation of such deals, and what is the significance of the earnings and the cash flows, how do we actually account for risk and investment that we make in future, and how do we come up with the maximum price which can be paid to the target company, and what is the best way to finance such a proposition. So we will take a break at this point.